Testing, testing. Good morning, Second Baptist. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. God has been good to me this week. Has he been good to you this week? Let us stand on our feet and praise the Lord for being such an awesome God. We thank him for he woke us up this morning to see a day we've never seen before. And for that, Lord, we say thank you. We have an opportunity today to stand in his feet and worship a true and living God.
Church, clap your hands. Come on now. Oh, yes, you did now. grateful now.
I'm so grateful.
Do-do-dip, do-do-dip, do-do-do-dip, do. Come on. Do-do-dip, do-do-dip, do-do-do-dip, do.
Happy New Year to each and every one of you. We want to be the first ones as pastor and the first lady on behalf of Dr. Janice R. Love and myself and the entire staff and officers of the Second Baptist Church of Olathe. We want to say Happy New Year to you.
Good morning, Second Baptist. I shall read scripture for you today from the Old Testament book of Genesis. Genesis, 37th chapter, verses 5 through 11. Those of you who have the strength and energy would ask you to stand in reverence to the Word of God. I shall be reading from the New American Standard. Your translation might be slightly different. Then Joseph, one of the 12 sons of Jacob, had a dream. And when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He told them, "Please listen to this dream which I have had. For behold, we are binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaves rose up and also stood erect. And behold, your sheaves gather around and bow down to my sheaves." Then his brother said to him, "Are you actually going to reign over us? Are you really going to rule over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. For he had still another dream and related it to his brothers and said, "Lo, I have had another dream, oh no. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me." He related it to his father, Jacob, and to his brothers. His father rebuked him and said to him, "What is this dream that you have had? Shall I and your mother and your brothers actually come to bow ourselves down before you to the ground?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept this saying in his mind. It's the word of God for his children. And now we will remain standing as Minister Kirk Sharp leads us in a word of prayer.
Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we've
gratefulness. We bow down before you this morning. We're grateful for all that you've brought us through this week, Father God. Grateful, Father God, for the ups and the downs, the trials and the tribulations. We're just grateful, Father God, for you, because we know that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we're grateful that we can press our way this morning, whether we be here in person or whether we're here online, that we can press our way to be here and worship you in spirit and in truth today. And we pray, Lord, that as we desire to worship you, that we can open our hearts, our minds, and our spirits to yield to your will and your way, that your spirit was already here, that we pray that we'll yield to your presence, God, and that we'll be able to worship you, Father God, edify you, lift you up, and that we know that when we lift up the name of Jesus, Father God, we know that blessings will be bestowed upon us. And so we desire to worship you, sing praises to your name, Father God, and we just want to be uplifted, Father God, in every way possible, Father God. So we pray, Father God, that as your spirit dwells with us, that you'll guide us through a worship experience that will strengthen us and encourage us and guide us. And we pray that something will be said or done that will encourage someone to get closer to you, that will lead somebody, Father God, in repentance. And Father God, we know that you are able to forgive, Father God, and lead and guide us to a relationship with you. And Father God, we just praise you. In Jesus' name, we ask these things. Amen.
Thank you. Martin Luther King Day is on Monday, January 16th. Do you smell that? I smell a chili cook-off coming up. Stay tuned for more details. Be on the lookout. Your 2022 contributions will be mailed out very soon. Be sure to join us for SBC Connect on Wednesdays at noon in person. Mark your calendars for the first Mobile Pantry of 2023 for Saturday, January 28th. Volunteers, don't forget to arrive by 8:30. Thank you. Black History Month is around the corner, and if you'd like to hear about some of those untold stories, you can join us online from 7 to 8 on Thursday, February 2nd to hear about the Tulsa Black Wall Street. You can follow the link below or reach out to Deacon Bruce for more details. Be sure to stay connected and have a blessed week, SBC.
Hey, what are you doing Wednesday? Since there's no football, might as well come down to Second Baptist Church of Olathe and join us for SBC Connect Bible study right here in person at noon. It's a wonderful way to stay connected and walk down your biblical journey with your church family. Also, you can grow with us by staying connected by liking us on Facebook, subscribing to our YouTube, and even tap that follow button on Instagram. Be sure to also remember to give, and you can do that by following the directions below. Hey, enjoy your service and the rest of your day, and I'll see you in a bit.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes, sir. Come on here. Yeah. Praise the Lord. We certainly are very grateful, amen, to all, for all that has transpired thus far. I tell you, all of them songs sound good today. Yes, sir. Amen. Appreciate it. Amen. Amen. You know, that's one of those deals like a, you know, Baptist preacher always say, y'all come to have church today. Amen. So we certainly are very appreciative of that. May God bless each and every one of you. We greet you in the strong name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we are very delighted to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Amen. And as I start, we certainly are very grateful for our associate ministers. God bless each one of you. Amen. We're grateful today for you and the prayers that you render, the support that you do, and we just thank God for each and every one of you on today. We are grateful for our deacons on today. It's good to see you all out today, and so good to see, amen, all of you. Our First Lady, amen. You know, January is a good special month, ain't it? I just want to let y'all know some very special people that's born in the month of January. And all of y'all are so special, but two of y'all are really special. One of them being my mother, amen, and amen. We just thank God for her 95 years, amen. And we celebrated her, and she's so happy, amen. And I know she's watching, amen, and then you know, that other fabulous woman that's born in January that's special to me. Now, all of y'all are special, but these two are special to me. Amen. Is this young lady in whom y'all call y'all's First Lady. Amen. Amen. As the little boy said on social media, that's my girl. Amen. That's on life. Amen. So we certainly thank God, amen, for our First Lady. And to all of you, amen, it's good to see you, and we're glad that you're here on today. Let me go ahead and get started. I've got a little Easter speech that the Lord laid on my heart, and amen, I thought I would share it with y'all today if y'all would indulge me for a few moments, amen. And I'd like to read in your hearing from the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 37, but I want to look at verses 18 through 20. 18 through 20. Amen. And if you all don't mind standing with me as we read this. And when they saw him far off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said one to another, behold this dreamer. Look at him, y'all. He comes. Come now, therefore, and let us slay him and cast him in some pit. And we will say, some evil beast devoured him. And we shall see what will become of his dreams. Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, we're grateful today for this day in which you have given us. We're grateful, Father, that we are recipients of your grace and mercy. And every morning we wake up, your loving kindness shows forth. And Father, your mercies are tender and they're fresh every morning. Father, as I stand before your people, Lord, I pray for preaching power. I pray for the movement of your Holy Spirit. And I pray, oh Lord, that you would touch the hearers' hearts, that when we hear your message, we would respond not only, oh Lord, in a way that that was a good message, but in a way, Lord, that will cause each of us to wrestle with the things that you are showing us spiritually, and that we would be activated to do something about it. We thank you. And then, Lord, if there is someone here today or viewing from afar that don't know you, let them know that today is a good day. And we give your name the praise, the glory, and honor. Let every heart say in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. And we're very, again, delighted to be in the house of the Lord one more time. And we do want to share with you that our Kids for Christ, amen, is in session. And those who are involved in that, you may leave now to go and be a part of that ministry. And we're very grateful for the workers in our Kids for Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. And on last week, my brothers and my sisters, amen, the Lord had shared with me to ask you a profound question. And it might not be so profound to you, but it is very important to the kingdom. Because I posed the question to ask you, is your light on? And we know that, amen, God has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light, and then he has inspired us, amen, that if we hold that light in our hearts and he has transformed us, that you and I are the light of the world. Problem is, my brothers and sisters, that sometimes, amen, we don't want to be that light. Sometimes, my brothers and sisters, we just up and turn the light out. Amen. But I pose this to have us to wrestle with, amen. If your light is on, amen, we need to keep it on in the efforts of what we are doing. The work that you and I do, the people we engage in need to see our light. The activities that you engage in, the lifestyle that you have, amen, your walk with Christ ought to demonstrate, amen, that your light is on. And as I indicated to you on last Sunday, amen, we all ain't the same wattage of lights. You don't have to be the brightest light in the box. Amen. But the thing of it is, no matter how dim your light is, darkness cannot overtake it. Just need your light to stay on. And then as your light is on, what is your witness? Amen. In your conversation, amen. And a lot of times, amen, our conversation doesn't have to be what we say with our mouths, but our conversation, amen, is the actions that we do. Talk back to me if you can. So I posed that question, amen, and even had a little bit of a humor added to it, because some of us, amen, we flick our light and on and off like we at the disco. Ooh, 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 ooh. Talk back to me if you can. But I want you to keep your light on. And if your light is on this morning, I want to move us now into this month of January. And we know that this is a month that we celebrate, amen, the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Amen. He was a father, a husband, a preacher par excellence, amen, civil rights leader, and a Nobel Peace Prize winner. Amen. Dr. King, amen, was somebody. And in this time of reflection, amen, we have to remember him in such a way that he moved a nation, amen, by his nonviolent actions, amen. But to be nonviolent takes something greater than yourself. The scripture says, thank you, Holy Spirit, greater is he that is within me than he that is in the world. Because you see, when you're trying to lead a group of people, amen, dealing with, amen, the struggles that we have in life, it's not easy. Amen. And you've got to have something on the inside when you're dealing with folk. Am I right about it? But today, my brothers and sisters, I want to remind us that most of the time, amen, we remember Dr. King from his speech, I Have a Dream. And we all are privy to that area where he says that I have a dream that my four little children would one day be able, amen, to be not judged by the color of their skin, amen, but by the content of their character. Now, what I want to submit to us on today, amen, that all of us have dreams. Amen. If you're not a dreamer, amen, you need to wake up and go back to sleep and try it one more time. But all of us ought to have some dreams. Amen. And sometimes the dreams that you have might not necessarily turn out like you want them to be. Amen. Sometimes our dreams, amen, when you're a little kid, you dream, I want to be a fireman, but amen, you might end up being something else. But it is still good to dream. And if you'll allow me, amen, just for a few moments, amen, and if I could indulge you, amen, I don't want to bust your bubble. We know Dr. King from his I Have a Dream speech, but I'm mindful that 3.5 years later, amen, he was interviewed and someone had asked him about his dream, and he basically stated that that dream had turned into a nightmare. Amen. You don't hear much about that, but today I want to talk to you just for a few moments. Amen, if I could, from this topic, this ain't the dream. Y'all gonna pray with me this morning? I know y'all come to hear about the dream, amen, but we've been saying the dream, amen, year after year, but I want to bring to our attention, amen, that every now and then we got to be reminded of where we are, amen, and that we got much more work that still has to be done. Y'all gonna pray with me this morning? Amen. This ain't the dream. There are four observations that I want to call to your attention this morning as we get ready to get into scripture, amen, is that we still got work to do. Verse number one, I want you to understand that, amen, not only do we got work to do, but I want you to look at this point. The vision of what God is showing us, amen, that's your point number one, is that we've got to be able to wrestle with that. The vision of what God is showing us. And then number two, we'll examine the struggle of working together. Somebody say that. Let's work together. Let's work together. Amen. Let's work together. Y'all gonna pray with me? Can I get it on this side? Let's work together. See, that's one of the hardest things to do, is to get folk to work together. Can I meddle just a little bit? It's hard to get your folks in your house. Y'all got kids? To work together. Amen. It's hard to get these football teams. Talk back to me. I know y'all team, one of y'all's favorite teams, lost last night because they wasn't working together. Amen. Let me move on from that. Amen. Verse, point number three that I want you to understand is that as we wrestle with this, we have to be able to look at the reality of the issues of our day. Then lastly, amen, I want you to be reminded, amen, about the hope that we still have. Is that all right? Let's look now, if you will, at the Genesis account. Genesis chapter 37, and it's a very familiar passage of scripture, and I would that you would take the opportunity to read it in its entirety. And I just want to highlight at verse number 5 of the 37th chapter of Genesis. Joseph had a dream. And sometimes your dream can get you in trouble. Am I right about it? I think I need to say that, Reverend Donnie, I got to say that again. Sometimes your dream can get you in trouble. Has anybody ever had a dream that or an idea or whatever, and you decided, man, boy, this is on me, and I got to share it with somebody, and then you go share it with somebody, and they just take the shotgun out. And it just falls down like a bird. And amen. And then Deacon Terrell, you say to yourself, boy, I should have kept that to myself. Am I right about it? I just need to know, has that happened to anybody? If that's happened to you, amen, don't be ashamed. Amen. Hold your hand up, amen. Because we all have had some dreams that have been shot down. Amen. And Joseph dreamed a dream. And this dream that he had, amen, he told it to his brother. See, the dreams that we have, we ought to be able to share freely with one another. Amen. Our dreams and our aspirations. Amen. But I stopped by to tell you that not everybody is for your dream. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, that's what holds us back. But Joseph, amen, he had his dream. And he shared it, amen. Not only did it say he shared it, but the King James Version say he told it. He told it to his brethren. And look at the response that he got. It didn't say that they disagreed with him. It didn't say that they wanted him to say that again. The scripture says, and they hated him yet the more. In other words, they already had some issues with him to begin with. Amen. And because they had issues to begin with, see, this is what happens to us. Amen. When folks already got issues with you, it don't take too much. Amen. For them, amen, to jump on you with all four, amen, feet. Talk back to me if you can. Amen. It says, and they hated him yet the more. You know, sometimes I hate to say it. Amen. I don't care what your profession is. Don't care what church you go to. Don't care what your position is. Amen. That is big right there. Let's walk just a little bit further. And verse 6, amen. Not only did he tell it to them, he said unto them, now watch this. Now he got the nerve for us to, y'all, you want me to listen to you now. Y'all see that? I ain't making this up. Y'all got to read the text. He said, here, I pray you. In other words, let me have your attention just for a few minutes. Deacon Vince, I want to share from them. I need y'all to listen to me. And he says, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field. And lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And behold, now here's where he get in trouble. Who done died and put you in charge? Amen. And behold, your sheaves stood around and made obeisance to my sheaf. In other words, bowed down. You done up and done it now. Joseph, you was doing all right until you said that. Now we know, brothers and sisters, that Joseph was the favorite child. And can I just meddle just a little bit? How many of y'all out here is y'all's parents' favorite child? Don't put your hands up. I see my daughter Jackie got her hand up. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's my baby big girl right there. Amen. But he said, y'all gonna bow down. And we see this. Amen. And let me hurry along and look at this. Now, verse 8. Says, and his brethren, this is their response, said unto him, shalt thou indeed reign over us? In other words, Dr. Wyatt, what's your intentions? Amen. You didn't share this information. Now, what's your intentions? Amen. Or shall it be indeed that you're going to have dominion? Watch this. Over us? See that? And they hated him. Yet the more his dreams and for his work. In other words, remember the stuff that they already had against him. Now he wants them to listen to him. They made him listen to his dream. Then told him that y'all, I'm really mad now. I'm really feeling some kind of way. Amen. Y'all see that? Amen. I just want you to get the flavor of it, and I promise I ain't going to keep you too long today. Amen. And so verse 9 says, and he dreamed, oh, Lord Jesus. This boy can't quit. Dick and Sean, he done up and had another dream. He said he dreamed yet another dream, and he told his brethren and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And guess what? Watch this. The sun, not the sun and the moon, and the 11 stars, they even bowed down. Y'all see that? I want y'all to see that. Okay, he's on a roll, y'all. Now watch this. Now he's talking to his brothers. Now he got to go talk to daddy. He said, told it to his father and his brother, and his father rebuked him. Now watch this. Every father, every mother, you try to get the siblings to get along, don't you? And you are the one that is the balancing act. And whenever there's favoritism, they're shown to one. Now, let's be honest. In every family, there is one of the children, and perhaps you might have been one of those children that you had to have a little extra. A little extra help. Amen? But the parents is the one that has to equalize the deal. So I imagine... Jacob said, now, Joseph, you can't talk like that all the time. Your brothers is getting upset, and you know, and you already got me in trouble. I got you that new fancy coat, and they mad about that. Now you talking about dreams, and you telling them that they're going to bow down to you. You ought not do that, Brother Glover. They're going to be mad. So he rebuked him. And he said, what is this dream that thou hast dreamed? In other words, where you get all of this from? Y'all see that? Then he goes on, now not only do you want them to bow down, not only are you talking about the sun and the moon, now you want mom and daddy to bow down. In other words, if I could put it in this way, you done lost your right mind. Y'all see that? Amen. And we're going to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth. Mm. And then his brethren envied him. And, you know, sometimes, let's say, you know, you got that one child that got ambition, that one child that's got initiative, that one child, amen, that you ain't really got to ask to do nothing. They always doing it. Am I right about it? Amen. But his brethren envied them. But his father, watch this, oh, Jacob back there, in other words, I can see in my mind, he said, boy, that's my boy. But he really can't say that. But he is watching and he is observing. Now that you got that particular context, all right, now what I want you to do is to move over to verse number 18. And I'm taking time to kind of set this up a little bit so that you get the flavor. And I want you not only to look at it from that vantage point, but we're going to be able to see ourselves in this text. See, one of the hardest things for a preacher to do, and I tell stories for a living, amen, is to take the scripture in its historical context and then share with you what is going on and then somehow bring it to a present day where you and I can wrestle with it, the same scripture, and then point us to the future where our help comes from. And see, that ain't always easy to do in 45 minutes. Now, I used to preach an hour and a half, so COVID made me shut that down. Amen. Now, all of this has happened. And then they decided to conspire against him. Now, what I want to let you know that sometimes when you have a dream and you're going to move mountains, amen, you've got to understand that some folk don't want their mountains moved. Let me see if I can do this. See, sometimes we're trying to change folk, amen, but sometimes folk don't want to be changed. Amen, because it requires accountability. It requires them to do something. Amen. It requires them to change some bad habits. Amen. That's why some folk, amen, don't want to give up what they're doing because they're so in love with it. Amen, that they're afraid that they're going to miss out on life if they are not, amen, always the life of the party. But when they saw him, who? When they saw Joseph, amen, afar off, and if you will, I can imagine it's just like this. You walk in a room, and everybody got quiet. What does that mean? They've been watching you. Here she come. Here he come. Y'all ain't liking me this morning. But even before he came near unto them, amen, they was plotting up against him. Now, they wasn't striking up the band and say, ooh, here come the dreamer. Woo, woo, woo. They wasn't saying that. So here he come. Here she come. Now look at him. And then they said one to another, behold, here he come. Now, therefore, since he's coming, let us slay him. And not only that, we're going to slay him. Now, some folks don't have to take your life. They can just slander your name. Some folks, amen, don't have to, amen, take you out. They can just, amen, put a wrench in the spoke. Some folks, amen, ain't got to try to, all they got to do is put their foot out and cause you to trip. Talk back to me if you can. Let's cast him into, now watch this, it says some pit. Now, there was a whole lot of pits, but this particular pit that they threw him in was an empty pit. It used to be a cistern. It had water in it, but it was empty during this time. Because, see, what happens is when you start conspiring, amen, thank you, Holy Spirit. And I think I want to pause here to give us a political aspect right now. Now, we know that the last several years in various administrations, there have been a lot of change that is going on that has caused a lot of problems. But what I want to share with you, you have to be careful. That is a double-edged sword. And y'all have heard me say from the podium, amen, be careful when you start pointing fingers. Amen. Be careful when you start trying to pass judgment on somebody else. Amen, because that same judgment and that other side of that two-edged sword, amen, will cut you as well. Right now in the political spectrum, amen, we were talking about classified documents, amen. Now all of a sudden, they done showed up again for the other side. Be careful. Don't wish evil on somebody else. Amen. We want the truth, but amen, let us not, amen, damage one another in the process. And they say, we will cast him in some pit, and then we will say, an evil beast has devoured him. And then we shall see what will become of his dream. Now, that was plural because, see, the first time he came, he said, you know, y'all, I had a dream. This, and then he kept on dreaming. Now, what does it have to do? Month of January, Martin Luther King, he too, a man, had a dream. And we take the excerpts from that because that is very novel. That is very good that we all hope that our children's children will grow up, amen, and be able to live in a society where their skin tone, amen, won't cause them injury. Amen. That's a good dream. And then not only that, let's take that further, that you can aspire, amen, for the highest offices of the land. And we've seen that happen. Amen. We've had a black president. We've had another Supreme Court justice. But what I want you to know, amen, is in this, in point number one, we have to understand that we still got work to do. The vision of what God is showing us, what he is showing us is that, amen, we still got work to do. Y'all gonna pray with me? You see, just because, amen, you have had a black president, that don't mean that racism don't exist. Amen. Y'all ain't got to shout me down. Amen. Just because you have a Supreme Court justice, that does not mean that racism has gone on vacation. You see, when Dr. King was giving his speech, amen, in August the 28th of 63, amen, the original intent of that message was to appeal to the end of economic and employment inequities. That was the intent. But see, we have forgotten that, and we focus on working on the color of our skin, being able to play together. But let's keep our eyes on the prize. The prize is that you've got to be able to have access, amen, to the jobs that are being created. You've got to be able to have access to good quality health care. And you've got to be able, amen, to rise above the occasion that when jobs are created, that all people are able to get a job that wants a job. But when the disparity is that when the employment numbers come out, when there is one group that has a larger disparity in the employment numbers, something's wrong with that. Then part of the dream that he had in that speech, amen, was talking about jobs and freedom. Now, you know, it's a strange thing is that you can be free but still locked up. Talk back to me if you can. See, you can be free to live wherever you want to live, amen, but don't you know that the Homes Association might have you locked up? And you might not even know it. I remember when I first moved, Sister Love and I, to our neighborhood, amen. Everybody want to know what kind of work you do. I don't go around ringing your doorbell, want to know where you work. I ain't talking about 1960s, I'm talking about 2000s. Hello, somebody. You know how the conversation, amen, they conversate, amen. People conversate with you, you know. Hi, Sean, how are you? Yeah, that's good there. Yeah, I see you come home at 4 and 5, amen. But that job's pretty hard. Trying to figure out what you're doing. To make sure you ain't selling drugs. Y'all ain't got to say amen. I'll say it for you. Amen. I ain't telling you something I read in the book. I'm telling you something that I know. Same way when you get a position on your job, somebody wants to know who you know to get that kind of position. Now, what's wrong with it? Why, amen, this is what Dr. King was saying, that my dream has turned into a nightmare. The dream is a lofty goal. The dream, amen, is one that will set our people free. But the nightmare is that we're still struggling with it. Amen. We have greatness amongst our people. And the vision of what God is showing us, amen, is that, amen, we can do great things. Next point that I want to show out, amen, is the struggle of working together. Amen. What we see here is that when Joseph's friend, you got to understand, Joseph in the Old Testament is symbolic to a Jesus. What do you mean by that? He's calling, no, I didn't say Joseph was Jesus. I said it is symbolic. And the symbolism is that he had in mind something that would show that Jesus himself would be who we would bow down to. Amen. And they took him and cast him in a pit. Now, there's a struggle of working together. And that struggle, my brothers and sisters, is real. And that struggle causes us not to, amen, support one another like we can and should. So verse 12 is where the nightmare began. And when you read that, he was sent by his father to go check on his brethren. Amen, because he know that sometimes, amen, them boys could get in trouble. But they resented daddy for sending the younger brother to check on him. And then he was deemed as the favorite anyway. But then we see, amen, that they decided to come against him. Y'all gonna pray with me? The struggle of working together. And don't you know, Second Baptist, that sometimes we struggle. Amen. You would think, amen, that collectively, just like the church did in the book of Acts, when they all got on one accord. Amen. Some miraculous things started happening. But you see, we struggle, my brothers and sisters, working together. Amen. They stripped Joseph and put him in a pit. But if you ever find yourself in a pit, and I want to tell you that sometimes when you share your dreams and your aspirations, and I told you that some of our dreams, amen, have turned into nightmares. But I have to tell you, I'm mindful of Psalm 40. And if you'll turn there with me or write it down, I want to tell you what you have to do when you find yourself in a nightmare, when you find yourself in a pit. David said, I waited patiently, amen, for the Lord. And he inclined unto me and heard my cry. And he brought me, watch this, up also out of a horrible pit. You see, sometimes your dream can turn into a nightmare. And can I just bring in some things? Sometimes you took a job that was your dream job, but when you got there, it turned into a nightmare. Am I helping somebody? Sometimes, amen, you might be in a relationship. And you think that relationship is all of that and a bag of chips, only to find out that it was a nightmare. I stopped by to tell you that that is, as my mama say, horrible. That is a horrible pit. But I'm mindful, if you will, that God is able. The psalmist found himself in a horrible pit. And it makes me wonder that prior to this, that he had dreams and aspirations. Have I got a witness here this morning? There ought to be somebody here that can identify with being in a pit. You've had a dream of living happy ever after, but your life turned into a nightmare. You've had aspirations of your children getting great jobs, but my, oh my, it turned into a nightmare. And you found yourself in a horrible pit. But I stopped by to tell us this morning that even though you might be in a pit, and even though your dream has turned into a nightmare, if I got any witnesses here, they'll tell you that the Lord, sure enough, will hear your cry. Is there anybody here that had to cry out to the Lord? And you found yourself in a pit of depression. You found yourself in a pit of a pity party. You found yourself in a financial pit. You found yourself in an emotional pit. And you found yourself shackled up and tangled up, mind combobulated. I stop by to tell you that your Lord can pick you up and turn you around and plant your feet on a solid rock. Look at David. He said he brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. Set my feet on a rock and established my goings. Ain't God good? I got to leave ya. But before I go, David said that when he picked me up, turned my dream back to a dream. He put in my mouth a brand new song. Ain't God good? He turned my mourning into gladness. Ain't God good? And I need to know, is there anybody here know what I'm talking about? I got to leave ya. I wouldn't keep ya this long, but good God from Zion, here he is. Got to tell it of how God can lift up a bowed down head. Come here, King. And King said, 3.5 years after I gave my famous speech, I was talking about equality, that folk ought to be treated like they're equal. When I told everybody and paid homage to Abraham Lincoln for signing the Emancipation Proclamation, that all men are created equal. Y'all don't hear me when I told them that I had a dream, and that dream would be one day for my children and your children, black children and white children, brown children and yellow children and red children and mixed children, would be able to play together, would be able to talk together, would be able to work together. When I told them I had a dream, y'all don't hear me, something happened. I thought everybody would work together, but look at here now. They conspired to take me out. Y'all don't hear me. Racism still exists. Y'all don't hear me. When a black man rises up, somebody got to feel a certain way. Y'all don't hear me. When I look at the NFL and see that 80 to 90% of his players are African American or people of color, but good God from Zion, right now, as I speak, they're firing black coaches left and right. So King will tell you that my dream turned into a nightmare. This ain't the dream. What do you mean, preacher? What is this? This is 2023, and you would think that we have rose above every condition, but I got news. Evil is always present. Racism is alive and well. Pharaoh still lives. Herod is still on the throne. But I got news. Ain't no Pharaoh. I got news. Ain't no Herod is over my king. For my Jesus is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he's able to set us free. Ain't God good? The reality of the issues of our day. We got folk right here in the state of Kansas that can't get
quality health care. I wish I had a praying church. There ought to be somebody here that would stand up and champion their cause. 150,000 Kansans can't get health care. Some folk say that they ought to work, but my God, if you get a job, make pennies. You don't make enough to afford health care. And if you ain't working, you ain't making enough to get the subsidies to buy it on your own. Something is wrong. We are living in a time when Jesus himself came and said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me. And that means he's empowered me to set the captives free. Our criminal justice system is faulting. Our criminal justice has the wrong idea. They lock up folk who've done minuscule things and let those who robbed you blind walk free. Talk back if you can. We're living in a time when folk can't go to the doctor and get the health care that they need. But I'm mindful of the Lord. He came through 42 generations. Didn't he come, y'all? And when he came, he began to make the blind folks see. Bernie, won't he do it? He'll do it. How do you know? If he did it for you, he'll do it for me. Thank God. All right. I got those. But before I go, my last point is we still have hope. Ain't God good? Joseph would tell you, I spent over 20 years in captivity. They threw me in a pit. They bloodied my clothes. They sent me off. But I grew up with my mind stayed on Jesus. Ain't God all right? And because I had hope in the God of my father, because I had hope in the God of my mama, because you have hope in the old folk who said that Jesus is our leaning post. Ain't God all right? Joseph elevated, the Lord picked him up, elevated him to be prime minister of all of Egypt. And then when the famine came, his family came, and those who thought that he was dead found out that his dream was alive and well. Ain't God good? Ain't God good? Look at Joseph. You got to go to chapter 50. His brothers were scared to approach him. But what I like about it, Romans 8 and 28 says it like this. And we know, nudge your neighbor and say, we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. Come on, Joseph. Joseph will tell you in Genesis chapter 50, verse number 20, says, but as for you, you thought evil against me. And I can hear King Satan, if he were here today, telling us that our dream turned into a nightmare. But I'm glad that we still have hope, because what was thought for evil when they took me out, but God, somebody say, but God meant it for the good. Ain't God good? I know God's good. How do you know? I got to close this thing out, but I heard Matthew's gospel, chapter 9, verse number 36 through 38. I need y'all's help, because it's one thing to talk a good game. It's one thing to say I'm with you. It's one thing to say everything gonna be all right. It's one thing to hold your hand up and say, Pastor, count me in. But I got to tell you that it takes more than a hand up. It takes more of saying you with somebody, because we have a whole lot of work that still has to be done. But when Jesus saw the multitude of the people, he was moved with compassion, because he knew what they needed. But the Bible says that my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches in glory. But when he saw their condition, he was moved, because they would have fell out and they were scattered all around as sheep that had no shepherd. I stopped by to tell you that there are some issues in this life that folk don't know what to do. They don't know whether to go or stay, turn left or turn right. But I stopped by to tell you that you are a bright light. You are a dreamer, and God wants you to be a part of the solution. And we know here at Second Baptist, and we know that all churches got a mission, and we know that God wants every soul to be saved. But not only that, he wants them to have life, and have life more abundantly. But how can you have an abundant life when you got oppression around your neck? How can you have an abundant life when somebody has got their foot on your neck? How can you have an abundant life when somebody is riding your back? How can you have an abundant life when you got problems that's weighing you down? But I stopped by to tell you that Jesus had the answer. He said, there's a lot of problems in this world. There are a lot of folk that need your help. The harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers unto the harvest. Can I leave you with one last thing? Second Baptist, you've been on the corner for 154 long years. We've been preaching and teaching. We've been singing and praying. We've been serving and shouting. We've been worshiping our God. But I stopped by to tell you that the Lord needs you. The Lord needs me to be a mouthpiece, to sound the alarm, to call out the things of this world that just ain't right. Y'all don't hear me. The laborers are few. Come on, come on, come on. I see our pantry. Y'all don't hear me. Whenever the truck comes, the laborers are few. Somebody ought to shout, amen. We need all hands on deck to make a difference in this world. Keep your light on. Keep on pushing. Keep on making a difference. I'm trying to quit, y'all, but every time I try to quit, I keep on thinking how good my God has been. Has he been good to you? He's shown up, been good to me. He done blessed my family. He's good to me. Thank you, Lord. You see, my dream could have turned into a nightmare, but my God turned my dream in a dream, because I still have hope. I got hope. My hope marched up. Doggone this heel one Friday. Y'all don't hear me. They nailed his hands. They riveted his feet. They hung him on that cross. And you might have said that it turned into a nightmare. But my God allowed him to be crucified and thrown in a pit of the grave. Y'all don't hear me. Is there anybody here that's glad that Jesus died for your sin? I'm trying to quit, but I gotta tell somebody that you still got hope. How come you say you got hope, preacher, when everything looks so bad? Unemployment looks so bad. Eggs cost over $5. Gas skyrocketed. Evil between one another. Blacks against whites. Browns against yellows. Tell me, how do you have hope? I'll tell you why I still have hope. For my Lord, when he was in the grave, it looked like a nightmare. The devil thought they had him. It looked like a nightmare. But one thing about our God, he said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. My God, who sits high, sit. Y'all don't hear me. A wake-up call. They tell me that early, early, early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. That's good news. You ought to shout, amen. Thank you, Jesus, for getting up. Thank you, Jesus, for providing us hope, hope for tomorrow. Thank you, Lord. He got up with all power in his hand. Thank you, Lord. thank you, Lord. If you're thankful, say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. Oh, yeah. He's all right. I know he's all right. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. We have hope. Hope is still alive. Our hope gives us what you and I need as believers to be able to rise to the occasion, to be able to fight racism, to be able to advocate for economic equity, and to be able to champion the cause for those who are without. And I want to let you know we got hope because he knows your name. And because he knows your name, he'll pick you up. He'll bless you. He's able. I want you to listen to the words of this song as the choir presents it before we extend the invitation. I want them to minister to you during this period. No matter what you're going through, no matter if all of your dreams turned to mush and was a nightmare, you still got hope because he knows your name. Come on, choir.
He knows my name. Yes, he does. And he knows my name. And he knows my name. And he knows my name. And oh, how he walks with me. And oh, how he talks with me. And oh, how he tells me. Yes, he does. That I am his own.
Invitation to Christian discipleship.
That I am your friend.
Will you come by letter candidate for baptism or your Christian experience testimony? Will you come?
No fire,
can burn me. No battle can turn me.
You come.
No mountain can stop me.
Sing it. Thank you,
in
Lord.
Your victory, because your power mm-hmm. is within me. Yeah. No giant can defeat me, because you know my hand.
No fire can burn me. No battle can turn me.
Thank you, Lord.
No giant can defeat me.
Is there one?
But you hold my hand. No fire can burn me.
There may be someone that standing in the need of prayer. We want to invite you to come down to the center aisle that we might be able to touch and agree in spirit. Extend to you the altar call at this time. Would you please come? If you stand in need of special prayer, if you have the faith, God has the power. He knows your name. He wants to bless you. Would you bow your heads with us? Heavenly Father, we come right now once again to call on your holy name. Father, we thank you for your message. Father, we still got work to do. But Father, we need you to do a work on us. Wash us on the inside. Renew within us clean hearts. And then give us a right spirit. That we might be able to work together. That we might be able to love together. To serve together. Father, we pray for forgiveness of our sins. And then, Lord, we're praying that those who are on their bed of affliction, we lift them up to you today, Lord, to heal their bodies, strengthen them, Master. Let them feel your presence. We thankful, O Lord, that you are God of gods. And then, Lord, we pray also that you be a light unto our pathways. Help us to hide your word in our hearts so that we won't sin against thee. Bless your people everywhere. Bless this church. Bless her efforts. Bless her members. We'll give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor. We claim the victory today. Let every heart say, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, amen. Yes, sir.
No battle can turn me, no mountain victory, 'cause your power is within me. No giant can defeat me, 'cause you
Praise the Lord. We'll have our last announcements, and then I'll be back for final remarks.
Thank you again for joining us today. Remember, the best way to grow with us is to stay connected with us. Make sure that you like us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube, and even follow us on Instagram. Oh, and by the way, go Chiefs. Bye.
You can stay connected on our website at secondbaptistchurchofolathe.org. Leviticus 27 and 30 says, "A tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord." Don't forget that you can give your tithes and offering through our Tithely app. Thanks, SBC.
Or you can drop it here in the church display in the lobby.
For those of you who are here in person, we certainly hope something today has been shared that will strengthen you along your Christian journey. Just remember that your dreams oftentimes will seem like they've turned into a nightmare, but you still have God's hope. And it is that hope that you and I can face all of our tomorrow. So remember that we're standing all over the building. We ask that you cross the aisle and hold somebody's hand. Father, again, we thank you for what our ears have heard, what our hearts have felt, what our eyes have spiritually seen in your word. We pray now, Lord, that you would go before us. Lift us up, O Lord, and keep us. Father, we pray that you would shine your face upon us. Give us your spirit to guide us. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, it rest, rule, and abide in all of our hearts, henceforth now and forevermore. And all of God's children said, God bless you and God keep you. Here's our prayer.